Good evening, everyone. So just we'll revise the first chapter of strategic financial management, financial policy and corporate strategy. In the past three classes, we have discussed this chapter in detail. Now let us recap whatever we have discussed and let us summarize most important chapter, though not for the examination purpose. So in your real life, for your career decision making, it is very important. Not only for this subject, ma, any subject, first chapters, though they are not important for the exam, but for your lifetime, it is important. The first chapters of any subject. Okay, right. So this is the financial policy and corporate strategy. Let us recap whatever I have discussed in the previous three classes and summarize those three. Okay, right. So first, the total first chapter, I'll divide into three parts basically. So one is objectives of corporate financial management, objectives of a corporate, not financial management. I'll say objectives of a corporate. Simply, I'll say objectives of a corporate. So there is a long debate, ma. There is a lengthy debate about this concept. What is an objective of corporate? Whether to do justice to the society or to earn more profit to the shareholders. So that is popularly called as shareholder capitalism and stakeholder capitalism. Shareholder capitalism means working only for the benefit of the shareholders. Stakeholder capitalism means working for the benefit of the entire community. Stakeholders, shareholders, employees, lenders, creditors, suppliers, local community, government, everything. Okay, whether it is shareholder capitalism or stakeholder capitalism, which is the appropriate objective of a corporate. There is a long debate going on. Okay, I'm not going to deep into that. Just for your information, I have given the debate. Okay, so first I'll discuss what is the objective of corporate. So the objectives of corporate, if you divide the two parts, what is the scope and for whom we are doing that? Okay, so first I'll write scope, objectives of a corporate. So objectives of a corporate. So first, what is the scope of the objectives? So what are the objectives to be achieved? Right. So the scope of the objectives and what are the challenges involved in achieving these objectives? Both we have discussed what is the objectives of corporate and what are the challenges involved in achieving those objectives. Okay. What is the objectives of corporate and what are the challenges involved in achieving those objectives? So scope, what is the objectives to be achieved? So if we discuss what are to be achieved and for whom we are doing, what we are doing and for whom we are doing. What we have to do and for whom we have to do. Two questions here. What we have to do and for whom we have to do. So therefore, I'll divide this into two parts. What and for whom. What the corporate has to achieve and for whom the corporate has to achieve. So scope, horizontal and vertical scope, both cross-sectional and time series. Okay. Right. So for what is the objectives of a corporate, what they have to achieve? First, the primary goal of a corporate is to maximize the wealth of the shareholder. There is no doubt about that. Maximization of shareholders' wealth. That is the first objective of corporate. Any corporate, it is the corporate here means I'm talking about what should be the mindset, what should be the decision-making framework of a top level, board of directors, what they have to think about. So their primary goal is to maximize the shareholders because it is the shareholders who have recruited them to earn money. So therefore, the objective of a corporate management is to maximize the wealth of the shareholders. There is nothing wrong in that. We have to do our duty. Even our so-called Bhagavad Gita says we have to do our own duty. Therefore, but there is nothing wrong if the board of directors fulfill their duties of maximizing the wealth of shareholders. Okay, right. That is maximization of shareholders' wealth. Next, meeting the expectations of shareholders. There is a difference between the maximization of shareholders' wealth and meeting the expectations of shareholders. The difference lies is this is a long term. So this I'm talking about, this is a long term strategy. So this is a long term objective and this is a short term. Okay. So one is long term, another one is a short term. Therefore, it is long term. Maximization of shareholders' wealth is a long term. And meeting the expectations of shareholders is a short term. It is a short-term activity. Okay, ma, right. So that is the maximization of. So meeting the expectations of shareholders. So this is yearly targets, not quarterly targets, yearly targets. So overall, our objective is to maximize the wealth of the shareholders. I'm talking about this wealth. Wealth is a long-term exercise. Wealth, creation of wealth will not happen over time. Creation of wealth will not happen over time. It takes long. It takes decades. It takes generations to build the wealth or to create the wealth. It takes generations or it takes decades also. Therefore, maximization of shareholders' wealth is nothing but a long-term activity, long-term objective. And meeting the expectations of shareholders, it is a yearly target. Say, for example, shareholders are expecting a rate of return of 18% or 20%. That they will change based on their other investment opportunities and based on the economic environment, they will keep on changing the expectations. So it is more about numerical. It's more about yearly expectations of return. So that is maximization of shareholders' wealth is nothing but increase of share price over a long period of time. Over a long period of time, increasing the market price. This expectation is nothing but yearly profit and loss account. In simple words, maximization of shareholders' wealth is a balance sheet exercise, and meeting expectations of shareholders is a profit and loss account exercise. Okay, so maximization of company share price and meeting the yearly targeted rate of return of 15%, 18%, whatever it is. Okay, right. Next, on top of that, there is one more thing. Non-financial item is that is fulfilling the aspirations of shareholders. Fulfilling the aspirations of shareholders. Fulfilling the aspirations of shareholders. It is a non-financial item. But till now, we have discussed the financial item. We are building the materialistic wealth for the shareholders. We are increasing the financial wealth or assets of the shareholders. Here, we are touching upon the psychological impact, psychological desires. Not only money, everybody expects beyond money. Not only just money, shareholders may be having some other desires, some other aspirations, what they want to do. So different shareholders of the company may be working for different things. Therefore, we have to fulfill their aspirations. We have to do the business in a manner to fulfill their aspirations. Not just money. They may be expecting something. They may be expecting that the company to be the market leader, or they may be expecting that the company should solve a global problem, a global phenomenon beyond that. So they are expecting that the company to solve most urgent requirement of the society. So therefore, beyond financial expectations, they will be having some other aspirations. That is called as fulfilling the aspirations of shareholders. Okay, all these things. Okay, all these things for whom? For who? Whose wealth you are increasing? Whose expectations you are meeting? Whose financial aspirations we are fulfilling? Both present stakeholders and future shareholders. Present shareholders and future shareholders. Present shareholders and future shareholders. In other words, sustainable growth. What we are looking is a sustainable growth. That we'll discuss later. Ma, separate topic. We'll discuss sustainable growth. Sustainable growth. That means we have to work not only for the benefit of the present shareholders, but also for the benefit of the future shareholders. We can't, if you don't, what is the balance? We have to balance both. If you don't do research and development, if you don't do sufficient research and development, what happens current year, you'll end up with more profits. If you pay the entire profits as dividend for the current year without reinvesting in research and development, you are satisfying the desires of the present shareholders. But how about the future shareholders? Whoever joins the company in future. So therefore, we have to meet the requirements of both present shareholders and also the future shareholders. That is called as sustainable growth. Okay, ma'am? That I'll discuss later. Next, to achieve these two objectives, what are the challenges involved? What are the challenges involved in achieving these two objectives? According to me, there are two challenges are involved. One challenge is peculiar to the whole world, and another second challenge is peculiar only to the India and the underdeveloped countries. Okay, right. So the first challenge is economic uncertainty. The first challenge is economic uncertainty. Now, in a fast-changing environment, technology is changing very fast, and people's aspirations are changing very fast. So therefore, nobody knows tomorrow what happens. Uncertainty, complete uncertainty. The pace with which the change is happening in the society is very vast. So changes are happening in the economy overnight. We can't predict the speed with which changes are happening in the economy. We can't even imagine the speed with which the economy is changing worldwide. We can't imagine the speed with which the economy is changing worldwide. That is the first issue. Another point, many aspects are interrelated. We may be focusing on one aspect that may affect other aspects. So So therefore, now the economy become complicated, and the relationship between variable factors operating in the economy is becoming complicated. If you try to satisfy one goal, definitely you are prejudicing the other goal. As simple as that. So therefore, the relationship between the various variables becoming complicated and in an unpredictable manner. So therefore, it is very, very risky. Economic uncertainty. If the economy is going well, if it is in case of 100 years back or 150 years back, no stiff competition, no high aspirations of the shareholders. If everything is well, all is well, then there is no need to break our head. We can easily achieving this is a cakewalk. If the economy is predictable, achieving those three objectives is a cakewalk. But now the economy is highly unpredictable. Therefore, it is very difficult to achieve those objectives. That is the reason we are having so many subjects, so many courses to break our head. If the economy is smooth and if it is easy to achieve, there is no question of MBA people, there is no question of so-called business schools, etc. And you and me, no need to break our head for financial management, strategic management, all this nonsense, because it is not so easy. The environment is not supporting us to achieve our objectives in a smooth way, right? There are a lot of complications or difficulties are involved. That is the reason we have to stress upon more. Knowing what to do is easy. How to do is very difficult. Knowing what to do is easy. How to do it is very difficult. Okay. Therefore, economic uncertainty. And the second factor, which is peculiar only to developing countries like India, is scarce capital. Financial capital scarcity. The first economic uncertainty applicable to the whole world, including developed countries like US and Europe. The second challenge lies only for the underdeveloped countries or developing countries like India. Financial capital, money is scarce. We can't invest huge amounts of money in technology or education, etc., or infrastructure. So this is the challenge. So therefore, we have to be very careful for achieving these objectives. We cannot sleep. We can't even sleep. Why the CEOs or CFOs will not get so smooth sleep? Because of this point. Because the environment is highly uncertain, whereas on the other hand, achieving the profit is becoming difficult. On the other hand, shareholders' expectations have been becoming increasing. The wider gap, expectations of the shareholders are increasing on one hand, and the complexity is dragging our profits on the other hand. Therefore, there is a wide gap between our achievement and the shareholders' expectations. There is a wide gap between the corporate achievement and the shareholders' expectations. Okay, right. So it is very difficult for the CEOs to keep the shareholders' expectations fulfilled. Okay, this is the objectives of a corporate. Okay, right. Next, what is the process of decision making or process of corporate management or process of running an organization? I'll simply call it as a process involved in running a corporation. There are many steps involved here. What is the process or steps involved? First, we'll split this into. According to me, there are six steps involved here. The first step is we have to scan the environment. So to identify which business to be done, we have to scan the environment. How will you maximize the wealth of the shareholders? First of all, we have to decide what business to do. We have to think about what business are available in the market. What is the business opportunities available in the market? First, scan the external environment. Environment means I'm not talking about natural climate. I'm talking about the economy. Scan the economy. So if you may be confusing, if I use the word called as environment, scan the economy, what? Local, regional, and national. Now there are no geographical barriers. Now the world is very flat. The world becomes a global village. That is what we popularly call as globalization. Now in order to earn money, you no need to work only in one country. You no need to do business only in one country. You can do business in any country. You can work in any country. Okay, ma. So therefore, we have to scan the environment all over the world to identify the business opportunities. We have to scan the economic environment all over the world. Local, regional and national. Scanning involves what is the problems facing by the society. How can I solve that problems? In a way, I can make the profits. As simple as that. So business lies in what is the need of the society, how I can fulfill that society, and how much should I charge for that services. As simple as that. So business is very simple. What is the need of the society? Out of those needs, or which needs I can fulfill, and how much I can charge for that, or how much the people can offer for that. As simple as that. Okay, that is the scanning the economy, local, national, regional, and national. Next, after scanning the economy, the second question comes is identification of business opportunities. After scanning, that means you are collecting the raw data from various sources. Identification of business opportunities, the second step. Third step is the most complicated thing. Okay, selection of business. So third step, selection of business to be done. So which business to be done? Selection of business involves many decisions. Look at this. What are the decisions involved here? Selection of business. One more to be there. Next, so the first decision in selection of business is acceptability. Okay, before selecting a particular business to be done, first analyze whether the shareholders are acceptable for that business. Some shareholders may not be willing to some particular kinds of business. Say, for example, some shareholders may be very ethical and they are very concerned about the society. They may not be willing to do the business called as tobacco or a soft drink or cool drink or what we call hot drinks, wine, whiskey, etc. So they may not be interested. I have seen some people who are not selling even cool drinks in their shop because they said that there is a lot of opportunity, but we are not interested to do that. So therefore, it is very important, acceptability, whether a particular business available in the society, whether the shareholders are acceptable for that, whether the shareholders like that business or not, whether that business will give the profit or not is secondary, whether the shareholders will like that business or not, that is the first thing. I remember when I'm doing articles, I have one of my colleague who cleared the CA ahead of me 6 months before me. He got a couple of opportunities from the banks, but he didn't join any bank. Even though good package is there, good position is there, he has not accepted any of the offers from the bank. I asked, Afroz, what happened? Why you are not joining any of the good banks? He gave only one reply. According to our Quran, interest-based economy is not permitted. The reply he has given is that interest-based economy is not permitted. According to Quran, interest-based economy is not permitted. So therefore, banking business is an interest-based economy, interest-based business, collecting interest. Therefore, I am not interested in the business. That is his aspirations. He has not even looked at the offer letter. He was least bothered about the package. He was least bothered about the promotions, or he was least bothered about the position given. He simply says, according to our Quran, this is not acceptable. So like that, that is a personal belief. It is about the personal belief of the shareholders. Some shareholders may not be interested to do tobacco business. Some shareholders may not be interested to do business in which more labor is involved. Okay, it's all about personal beliefs. So therefore, the business we have selected must be acceptable to the shareholders. Selected business must be acceptable to the shareholders. Managers should select only those businesses which are acceptable to the shareholders and the local community also. Okay, this is what acceptability. First, we have to do this. Forget about all your financial techniques called as capital budgeting, IRR, or ratio analysis. Forget about all those stuff. If the shareholders does not like a particular business, what is the fun in evaluating those business? It's illogical. It's just a waste of time. You have spent lot of time. You have paid lakhs of salary to the finance professionals, and you have spent months together to analyze a particular business, like for example tobacco business, or for example any other business. After evaluating and selecting the business, end of the day when you went to the shareholders for acceptance, the shareholders has rejected their proposal. All your efforts and money has been gone. So therefore, first you have to understand, forgot about your financial feasibility, etc. First we have to understand whether this business will be acceptable to the shareholders or not. As simple as that. So therefore, first is acceptability. And the second one is after doing the acceptability analysis, second one is feasibility analysis. Yes, feasibility. Yes, shareholders will be acceptable with a particular business. Yes, I am doing the technology, I am doing the what we call manufacturing business. Shareholders are very much interested in that business because it generates a lot of employment, etc. So therefore, I have selected the businesses. So out of those businesses which I have selected, which is acceptable to the shareholders, then I have to evaluate what is the resources required, whether the kind and quantum of resources is possible for the company to acquire. Okay, so managers should select those business. Here, managers is nothing but directors or CEO, etc. Okay, managers should select those businesses which are feasible to implement. Keeping in view the kind and quantum of resources required. This is the first point. So keeping in view the kind and quantum of resources. So what kind of resources are required? How much resources are required? How much capital is required? How much labor is required? How much technology is required? Will I have all those things? Or will I be in a position to acquire all those required resources? Then I'll select. If a particular business is there, which is acceptable to the shareholders and but the capital requirement is very huge. I don't have that much of capital. Even I can't procure that much of capital also. I am Aditya. If I go to the capital market, if I go to the banker and ask 1,000 crores, loan, nobody will give to you that 1,000 crores loan. As simple as that. So therefore, I can't do a business which involves 1,000 crores capital. That is not feasible for me. Forget about the profitability of that. That is not possible for me also. As simple as that. So therefore, first we have to check out the feasibility. After acceptability, the first stage of screening out is acceptability. The second stage is after selecting the acceptable businesses, then you have to analyze the feasibility. For each business, what is the kind and quantum of resources required? How much is the resource I can procure? How much is the resource I have? And how much is the resources I can procure? Okay, based on this, we'll select this feasibility. And next, after selecting the feasibility, the third point is profitability. Okay, ma? So profitability. So here profitability. Here comes is our financial techniques called as capital budgeting, ratio analysis, and all those things. Here we are applying the financial tools to evaluate the project, to evaluate the feasible business projects. Profitability. It is nothing but profitability decision or investment decisions. Profitability or investment decisions involves evaluating the risk returns. Evaluating the risk and return from each product. How much risk is involved and how much return I can expect from a particular business. This is called as investment decisions or also called as capital budgeting or financial tools. Okay. So using the financial tools, you can evaluate whether the project is profitable or not. And next, last point is suitability. So a particular business is acceptable to the shareholders, is feasible for us to implement, and it is giving more profits, but it will not fit with other objects. It will not fit with other business, as simple as that. So I'm not doing a single business, I'm doing multiple businesses. Nowadays you are seeing most conglomerates like Reliance, Tata, Aditya Birla Group. They're all conglomerates, they're engaged in multiple businesses. Whatever the business I have selected, that should fit with all the other businesses. It's like a teamwork. I cannot recruit an employee who is more talented, but who will not fit with the team, who is not able to do the work among the team members. So therefore, suitability. This first point is suitability. It is called as portfolio decision. After evaluating the business on a standalone basis, in the next stage, we have to evaluate on a relative basis. Absolute analysis and relative analysis. These are the two different types. Absolute evaluation and relative evaluation. First, I look at the project on its own, standalone basis, whether it gives profit or not. After selecting the profitable businesses, out of those profitable businesses, I'll filter out which of these businesses will fit with our existing strategy, which will fit with our existing businesses. That is the overall fit. That is called as suitability or portfolio decisions. Portfolio decisions involve evaluation of contribution of a particular business to the other businesses. How a particular business opportunity how a particular business opportunity fits within the overall strategy. Okay, ma, this is what the point. Suitability. This is the fourth point. So selection of business involves these four steps: acceptability, feasibility, and profitability. Okay. So the first step is scanning the environment, local, regional, and national, and identification of business opportunities. After identifying those business opportunities, then we have to select it. This is the third step. And the fourth step, after selecting the business, frame the strategy. We have to frame the strategy. So this is also involved three levels of strategy. Frame the strategy. Next, so strategy formulation or preparation of strategy. It is also called as formulation or preparation of strategy. Fourth step. So the strategy formulation. The strategy formulation involves three things. So first thing, strategy formula is corporate level strategy. What kind of strategies will formulate? The objectives of corporate level strategy at corporate level is configuration of resources. What is meant by configuration of resources? Configuration of resources refers to deployment and redeployment of resources in a changing economic environment. What is profitable at present may not be profitable after 10 years. So therefore, whatever the resources we have invested in one particular business, we have to pull out those resources, we have to shut down that business, and we have to start other business. Therefore, redeployment of resources. That means shuffling of the resources among the business. We may not stick on to one particular business. We are doing 10 businesses. Out of those 10 businesses, maybe 3 or 4 businesses can be forever. They can be enduring. Okay, but maybe some businesses which are only temporary, which cannot have permanent future. So therefore, we have to pull out the resources from those short-term businesses and we have to invest in some other business. That is called as reshuffling or configuration of resources or redeployment of resources from one business opportunity to the another business opportunity. This is what will be done at the corporate level. Next, at the business level strategy. For each business, how I can be the market leader in the business, how I can increase the sales in a particular business, how I can increase the profits in a particular business. It is nothing about achieving competitive advantage. Now in the era of competition world, I am not the monopoly. Monopoly is gone on the days. Now the highly competition is there. So in case of stiff competition in any field, there is a stiff competition. So in order to survive in the stiff competition, forget about the growth. So first of all, focus on the survival. How I can survive? How I can at least barely meet the expectations of the shareholders? Forgot about beating them. At least barely I can meet the expectations of the shareholders. Achieving competitive advantage. Can I produce whether I should go for cost effective goods or whether I should go for premium goods with high quality? That means that is what we have learned in cost leadership and differentiation strategy. You might have learned in your CA inter strategic management, cost leadership and differentiation strategy, achieving competitive edge. How I can serve? I should have something unique to me, whether it may be low cost or high quality. Something unique should be there from my perspective, or a brand name. Some uniqueness should be there. So in that case only, I'll take some kind of customers. In the competition age, I may not be able to grab the entire market. At least I have to procure some portion of the market. For that, I should be unique in some aspect, which is likable to some of the citizens or some of the stakeholders. I may not be impressing all the stakeholders, but at least I can impress a particular segment of the stakeholders. That is called as fragmentation or compartmentalization. Okay, that is called as business level, achieving competitive advantage. Next, the third functional level. So this functional level strategies involves coordination of resources for the productive use. Say for example, suddenly in the finance function or finance department says we don't have sufficient capital, we don't have sufficient money at this point of time. How you can manage? So then we have to go and speak with the production. Can you stop the production for a particular period of time, or can you go and meet the marketing people? Can they reduce their marketing expectation or go and meet the HR? Is it possible to lay off certain employees? So it has to be coordinated. So HR will convince, okay, for two months, I can manage with less employees. I'll reduce the outsourcing. I can manage with less employees for 2 months. Therefore, that is a coordination of the lack of financial resources will be compensated by the human resources, or will be compensated by the marketing resources. Sometimes suddenly we are launching a new product. So therefore, marketing departments requires huge advertisement. In that case, finance department should be able to reduce the expenditure from the other departments, and they should be able to give the more money to the marketing. That is called as a coordination of resources for the product to use, for the product to use of each resources. So coordination of resources. This is the third point. Functional level strategy involves coordination of resources. This is the fourth step. So strategy formulation is broken into three parts: corporate level, business level, and functional level. So these are the corporate level configuration of resources, that is deployment and redeployment of resources, or the business level strategy involves achieving competitive advantage, and functional level strategy involves coordination of the resources. Okay, right. Next, fifth point. So after strategy formulation, we need to procurement of finances. Procurement of required financial resources. This is the key. Money is the source for everything. Procurement of financial resources. It involves procurement of financial resources. It involves deciding first of mix of equity and debt in the capital structure. So this you are familiar. Capital structure decisions. So after how much equity should I have, how much debt I should have. There is no ideal rule. There is no one size fit for all concept. That means each business will have their own unique debt equity ratio. And for each business also, based on the economic environment, debt equity ratios will change. If the economy is running into recession and there will be more uncertain, less probability of getting profit, then we'll increase the equity component. Because debt component is risky. Whether or not you are getting the profits, you have to pay the interest. So therefore, not only based on the business risk involved, but also based on the economic position, will decide about the level of the debt. Okay, therefore, how much should be the equity, how much should be the debt. In case of the economy is booming, economy is prospering, yes, I can use 20% of equity and 80% of debt. If the economy is running into recession, I'll use the reverse. I'll use 80% of equity and 20% of debt. So it's not 80-20, you can take 40-60 or 30-70, any ratio. But the debt equity ratio depends upon the type of business you are doing and depends upon the stage of economic development. Okay. Right. There is a mix of equity and debt in capital structure, and within the debt, mix of long-term, medium-term, and short-term debt. So within the debt, we have to decide about the long-term, how much is the long-term debt, how much is the medium-term debt, and how much is the short-term debt. Long-term debt is usually for the fixed assets. Short-term debt is usually for the working capital or current assets. Okay. Medium-term debt, you can utilize for any of those things. Okay. Right. Next. Procurement of financial resources. After procuring the resources, the last step involved is establishing management control systems, both operational controls, financial controls, administrative controls, strategic controls, controls for proper implementation, for avoiding the wastage and achieving the results in a time-bound manner and for with less wastage of resources. Okay, so the sixth step is establishment of controls. This is also called as management, strategic financial management. We have discussed about the strategy. This is about financial, and sixth point is about management. Strategic financial management, fourth, fifth, and sixth points. Fourth point is a strategy, fifth point is a finance, sixth point is a management. Management controls, establishment of controls. So without this is where the most of the people will lack. Planning is good, everything is good, but execution is bad. Because of lack of proper control, lack of discipline, all those things. So therefore, establishment of controls, operational, financial, etc. Operational and financial controls. So different kinds of controls we have to establish. So these are the six steps involved. Summary, what is those covered in our syllabus? These are the six steps involved. Scanning the environment, identification of business opportunities, selection of business. Within selection of business, four strategies, acceptable, four tests. Selection of business has to pass four tests. First test is acceptability, second test is feasibility, third test is profitability, and fourth test is suitability. Okay. So thereafter, strategy at the three very different levels and procurement of finances and establishment of controls. So whatever we have done, fine, one cycle is done. This has to be continued. This is not a one-time activity. Whatever we have done from the scanning the environment till the establishment of control, that has to be done in a recurring exercise. Corporate is a going concern. We are discussing our auditing. Corporation is a going concern. So it's an enduring activity, not a one-time activity, because we have to meet this. We have to meet this not only for the present shareholders, but also for the future shareholders also. Sustainable growth. Not only for the present shareholders, but also for the future shareholders. Okay, look at this sustainable growth. I'll discuss sustainable growth in two parts. One is at the corporate level, another one is at the economy level. Both are covered in the syllabus. I'll discuss both sustainable growth or sustainable growth. So what is sustainability at the corporate level and what is sustainability at the wide economy level? Okay, right. So sustainability at corporate level and at economy level and corporate level. Okay, right. Sustainability at corporate level and sustainability at economy level, at economy level. So at corporate level, the sustainability refers to, first of all, the sustainability. What is the first of sustainability? As we discussed, meeting the requirements of not only the present shareholders, but also the expectations of the future shareholders. So therefore, at corporate level, we need to meet the requirements of present as well as future stakeholders. That is the first point. Next, another point is the growth, the rate of growth, whether you need to grow by 10% or whether you need to grow by 30%, etc. Neither too slow nor too fast growth. Okay. So what happens if you grow very fast? It is risky. What happens if you grow very fast? It is risky. If you aim for a 50% increase of market share every 50% increase of sale every year, you want to grow faster, you want to become a market leader in 2 years or 3 years, then what you will do? You will do aggressive expansions. You will borrow huge money. Therefore, there is a chances of failing. So therefore, too fast growth is dangerous because there is a possibility of failure. There is a saying in English which goes like, hasty climbers have sudden falls. Therefore, you can't have targets which are very high, which are unreasonable to achieve, and which are unreasonable to highly ambitious targets. That is what is the problems faced by most of the corporates. The problems faced by most of the corporates is setting highly ambitious targets which are not possible to achieve. Therefore, we should not grow too much of fast. There will fall. At the same time, we cannot grow too slow because our competitor will overtake us. So we want both growth and stability. That means we want both safety and speed. We have to manage speed without endangering the safety. We have to manage speed without putting the safety into risk. So therefore, neither too slow. If you go very too slow, our competitor will overtake us, will not grow. So therefore, we want to grow, but at the same time, we don't want to fall. We have to ensure that we will not fall. The speed, in order to grow, we have to grow speed, not very slow. But the speed should be such a manner that we should not fall. Okay. Therefore, neither too slow growth nor too fast growth. Depends upon the environment, economic environment, and depends upon the competitive position. We have to set our growth target. Okay. Right. As much as the market conditions allow. We have to grow sales as much as the market conditions allow. Right. That's it. Neither too slow nor too fast growth. Now comes to the financial. Right. So, Sustainability has to take into account leverage. Next, asset utilization. So before setting the growth targets, what are the aspects to be covered? Leverage, asset utilization, profitability and dividend payout. This is our point. Leverage. So how much we can grow based on the reasonable level of debt. So without debt, you will not grow. And at the same time, with too much debt, you will fall. without debt we will not grow, without debt our growth will be very slow, and with too much debt our growth will be very fast. So therefore, in order to balance that our growth speed is neither too slow nor too fast, we have to take the appropriate level of leverage. That means bearable level of debt, bearable level of debt, reasonable level of debt. So therefore, our growth target should depends on our growth target depends upon what is the level of debt we can bear. What is the level of debt we can bear or we can tolerate? Okay, so a bearable level of debt. Our growth target depends on the bearable level of debt. And second point, after setting that, okay, we can borrow 30% debt and we can use 70% equity. Okay, with this, how much assets I can procure? With this, how much assets I can procure? I can procure 4 machineries. So how much I can use that machinery? Because that means whether I can work for 100% capacity utilization may not be possible. 100% capacity utilization may not be possible. Therefore, I'll fix at 80% or 90%. And at the same time, I cannot keep the assets idle. I have with the level of debt available, with the level of capital available, I have procured 4 machineries. But how much I should use those machineries? I cannot keep that machineries idle. I have to work to the fullest extent possible. That is 80 to 90% capacity. That is asset utilization. So how much of amount I have, both equity and debt, with that amount, how much fixed assets I can procure, with that how fixed assets, how much sales I can make, with ensuring that fixed assets are not sitting idle. That is a sale target. And in order to make the profit, how much sales should I make? Profitability. If I make this much of sales, whether I'll get the profits or not. I need to meet the requirements of profitability, requirements of the shareholders also. Profitability requirements. Okay, right. Next, dividend payout. Say for example, I have 10 crores money. Okay, I have only 8 crores, my own capital 8 crores. I can borrow debt of only 20%. I can bear only 20% of the debt. Okay, so I have 8 crores money. I borrowed 2 crores money. I got 10 crores. With that 10 crores, I can take 4 machineries. Done. So if I utilize all the 4 machineries, in order to utilize all the 4 machineries, how much sales I should make? So I have to make, say, for example, 1 lakh tons or 10,000 tons, I have to make the sales. I have to sell 10,000 tons. Fine. So in order to ensure that the assets are not keeping idle, assets are not put to the best use, I should make 10,000 sales. Fine. But whether there is a sufficient demand in the market, whether the competition conditions will allow me to make that much of sales depends upon. So if the competition conditions are very severe, and in order to make too many sales, you have to reduce the sale price, you may incur the losses. That is not the correct. Don't go for that sales. Even though sales are possible, but if it is not giving sufficient profits or adequate profits, don't go for that level of sales. We have to fix the level of sales in order to ensure to get the profit bottom line. It doesn't matter how much you eat. What matters is how much you digest. It doesn't matter how much you eat. What matters is how much you digest and how much of what we eat is converted into energy. You may eat so many things, but how much of that is scrap and how much of that is will be converted into our energy, that is what matters. So therefore, how much of the sales we made is irrelevant if there is no profits. How much of you ate is very irrelevant when you are not able to digest, when you are not able to retain something energy in your body. So therefore, in a similar manner, so how much of the asset we have utilized is of no use, it should get the profits also. This is the mistake done by most of the startup companies. With a view to get more sales, they are sacrificing the profits. Just to increase the market sales, they are selling the goods at losses. No, that should not be a sustainable strategy. Sustainable strategy means we have to fix the sales with a way to get the profits. So in order to get the profits, I can make only 100 quantities of sales. Because with the sale price I fixed, I can make only 100 quantities of sale. Okay, I cannot make beyond that sale with that sale price. Yes, doesn't matter. You can't go for 1,000 quantities of sale, 1,000 quintals of sale and get the losses. Okay, so therefore we have to fix our sales level target and to ensure that the profits will be obtained. So even though the level of sales may be less, but it should give the profits. Just because the sales are more, you should not sacrifice the profits. We can't make too many sales which results in losses. End of the day, whether you sell for 100 rupees or 2 rupees or 100 rupees, we should get some amount of profit. Sustainability. With profits only we can sustain. Okay. Therefore, assets should not keep idle. We should not borrow more money. We should not keep the assets idle. And we should not sacrifice the profits. And we have to make the dividend payment also. We have to make the dividend payout. We have to pay the dividend, required dividend by the shareholders. How much dividend I should pay? How much the dividends are expected by the shareholders? So that much sales I should make. Okay, right, dividend payout. So this is at the corporate level. These are the points to be kept in mind at the corporate level. Leverage, asset utilization, profitability, and dividend payout. Okay. Next, at the economy level, what are the aspects to be kept in mind? Sustainability, what is meant by sustainability at the economy level? There are three aspects. Here there are three aspects, three versions of sustainability at the economic level. There are three versions of sustainability. first version is very weak version. Very weak version of sustainability. So this is one method of one argument. Here versions means arguments of group of people. Some group of people are arguing about something that is called as weak, very weak group. That we have nomenclature as a very weak group. So some group of people arguing. What is the argument by some group of people? So some group of people are arguing that we have to keep our infrastructure and capital assets constant. We have to keep our capital assets constant and infrastructure constant. Okay, constant capital assets. That means what they will say is that I cannot construct many buildings. Whatever the buildings I should have, I have to keep those same buildings even for the next 100 years also. I cannot construct more buildings because construction of more buildings nothing but taking away of agricultural land and taking away of rivers, etc. So therefore, very weak strategy says we should not increase the capital. We should not increase the infrastructure. That this infrastructure is sufficient. We can't go on building new roads. We can't go on building new apartments. We can't go on building new factories, which generates pollution. New roads will take away the agricultural land, more houses will take away the rivers, etc., and more factories, more production of goods will take away the quality air. So therefore, it will result in air pollution. So therefore, this weak version of sustainability says no, enough is enough. Whatever we have built, the infrastructure, roads, houses, enough. Don't increase it. Because if you the more you increase the infrastructure, etc., we are compromising the environment. Therefore, let us keep the infrastructure constant. Don't build any new house, don't construct any new highway, don't open any new factory. Constant capital assets. That is very weak. It is not possible. The second point, weak version of sustainability. This weak version says, yes, we have to increase in a manner that to meet the requirements of the future. That is what we are following at present. So based on the future requirements, so why we are building too many apartments? Because the population is increasing. For the ever-increasing population, the present houses, residences may not be sufficient. So therefore, weak version of sustainability says, no, we have to increase the capital with a view to meet the requirements of the present and future generations. So we have to increase the capital, keeping in mind the requirements of future generations also. Okay, increase the capital, keeping in view the requirements of future generations. Increase the capital, keeping in view the requirements of future generations. This is the weak version of sustainability. And the strong version of sustainability. One more version is the strong version of sustainability. This strong version of sustainability says we have to build the capital assets or infrastructure to the extent that will not damage the environment. This is the correct strategy. We should not damage the environment. At the same time, we have to meet the requirements of all. What? How to do it? Sacrifice, as simple as that. This very weak version says, don't satisfy the needs of the people. With a view to satisfy the needs of the people, don't damage the environment. Don't damage the environment. This says satisfy the needs of the people even by damaging the environment. Okay. So this very weak strategy says don't damage the environment. Our top priority is environment. Don't touch the environment. Okay. Don't sacrifice even a small portion of the environment. Keep the assets, capital assets constant. So let the needs of the people will sacrifice. But here the weak says let the people's needs be satisfied. Let the environment compromise. That is weak version. And the strong version says we have to increase the capital asset to the extent of not damaging the environment. So if in the process of increasing the capital assets, in the process of increasing the infrastructure, etc., if at all you reach a particular stage where you thought that environment is at peak level, the pressure on the air quality and water quality is very huge, then you have to stop the development there. Then we have to start a lot better. And we have to stop our income expectations. We have to stop our aspirations there because it is not possible anymore. So I have purchased one house. I can't keep on constructing more houses because the environment does not permit me. That is what the point. Therefore, a strong version of sustainability says so. Capital assets has to be increased to the extent not damaging the environment. Capital assets has to be increased. To the extent environment is not damaged, to the extent environment can bear. or tolerate, to the extent environment can bear or tolerate. This is the strong version of sustainability. Though it is done at the economic level, the economy level is the policy makers, government. But why we are doing, we are the corporate professionals, why do we bother about this? Yes, it is the corporate professionals who will guide the policy making. There is nothing unusual. Okay, corporate professionals will be behind the government, will be guiding the government in their physical and monetary policies, etc. So therefore, it is necessary for a corporate manager to know what is the level of acceptable growth. What is the level of acceptable growth? Emma, this is all about the first chapter. I have recapped and I have summarized all those points. Let us go back and revise my theory material completely. You can understand. A couple of times, we have tested 4 marks question in this chapter. So one time or one attempt or the other, frequently we'll get 4 marks question from this chapter, financial policy and corporation. Strategy, just go through the theory. This is the key points. Okay, ma? Right. So tomorrow we'll start the second chapter called as risk management. Bye, ma. See you. See everyone.